Hi, Anthony.
Hi, Liz.
You're in regular contact with CEOs and business leaders across Europe. How would you characterize the sentiment there right now?
Yeah, I'd say that CEOs have been through the same roller coaster ride that all of us have been through. And it really feels like it's been dictated by three phases over this period. The first phase really was driven by assessing the immediate human and financial impact, you know, and by chief executives really trying to focus on business continuity, on liquidity, and on effecting the lockdown in as sensible and sympathetic a fashion as they could. You know, the second phase was a period of stabilization where protocols and procedures were being put in place to work from home, and where chief executives were really just focused on trying to get to a period of as much visibility as possible on the short-term performance. And the final phase, which, you know, feels like we're in right now, has really been driven by much more focus on what you expect CEOs to focus on, which is, well, as running the business day to day, trying to work out how to get businesses really into growth mode and focusing on that in the short and the immediate term.
So what are some of the biggest considerations on business leaders' minds as we move into the fall?
You know, I think the biggest focus that we've spent time on with most of our client base has been around trying to get their head around assumptions driving the underlying economy and the trajectory of the underlying economy, and of course, the trajectory of the virus. As they've spent time on that, and as we spent time on that, we focused on a myriad of questions, none of which will surprise you, but a lot of them are focused on the timing of a vaccine, which is clearly hugely important here. A lot of them have been focused on the shape of consumer recovery and the shape of consumer behavior linked to the vaccine. And of course, a significant focus, you know, on the degree to which fiscal support from governments around the world can continue and what happens when those schemes taper. I'd say overall, there's no question that CEO confidence has been lower. That won't surprise you. And they've been very internally focused and internally focused on the right things, which is, you know, the safety and health and well-being of their people. But I'd say the good news is that in the last few weeks, there's been a very noticeable shift in CEO confidence and a sense that they are starting to think a lot more strategically. And while it is early, there's clear signs of a pickup in M&A activity in that regard.
And what about the broader landscape? What are the biggest issues that business leaders in Europe are focused on right now?
Unsurprisingly, the biggest focus, you know, as we, you know, we head into September, October is on return to office. And look, we all know how complicated it is to navigate this. And it's very well documented, you know, the degree to which most corporates have felt that they've operated incredibly efficiently and productively during this period of lockdown. You know, nonetheless, we continue to hear that most chief executives are concerned about their ability to drive R&D and to drive innovation, you know, in a remote working environment. And therefore, you know, there is a focus on, you know, getting people back into the office, you know, obviously safely, in order to, you know, to continue to nurture R&D and actually just nurture and focus on culture. Look, the other big thing we've been spending time on with corporates is scenario planning. You know, I touched on this earlier. As people start to think about the forward and think about growth, they are trying to work out what their base case is and what their upside and the downside cases are. You know, what's been interesting about that debate is they've come to a place where they're less focused on the internal drivers of those, which they think they've got their head around, and more focused on the geopolitical issues, which are looming large now. You know, and there's a myriad of those. Clearly, US-China relations continues to dictate the agenda. I'd say here in Europe, the looming Brexit deadline is a significant consideration, as is, you know, notwithstanding the successes of the EU today, you know, the focus on some of the financial issues in the southern area of the Eurozone. Of course, there's a focus on the emerging markets and the dynamics there and what that means for supply chains. And of course, you know, a increasing focus on the implications of the presidential election for, you know, for business leaders around the world, but also in Europe. The only other thing I touch on is balance sheet. You know, look, we've, as I said, we've moved out of this period where liquidity was a big debate, you know, to a period where I think most chief executives are spending some time more philosophically thinking about what is the optimal balance sheet for a corporate in a post-COVID world. And that, you know, ranges from what's the right dividend policy, you know, what's the right leverage, how should I think about capital in a low to negative interest rate world, you know, how should I think about government financial support, you know, and a number of other those issues. But I'd say those are the key themes that are framing the debate as we head into the autumn.
So you mentioned the growth mindset amongst business leaders in Europe right now. How do you think that might translate into strategic activity?
As we start to see stabilization in infection rates in Europe, which is clearly critical to people having greater confidence to transact in the M&A environment, you know, we do think we'll see a pickup in M&A volumes. You know, it's interesting when you look at the statistics for Q2 in Europe, we saw just under 40 deals above $1 billion take place in the second quarter in Europe. If you then start to drill into that in a little bit more detail and try and understand what's driving that, really the theme has been corporate sales and corporate spin-offs, which is consistent with the overall theme of corporate simplification that we've seen for the last year or two here in Europe, but also globally. And as you know, it's a trend that hitherto was driven by the equity markets, really questioning whether conglomerates can create superior returns for shareholders. You know, it was then further capitalized by a pickup in activist activity as activists push for breakups of conglomerates and driving some of the parts value liberation. But I'd say what's interesting about this crisis is it is further catalyzed that because corporates have felt a need to clarify their strategy and purpose against the backdrop of this uncertainty. And it's created a need for restructuring in any event. And I think most corporates are thinking that as they go through this restructuring, it is a good time to exit non-core businesses. You know, our suspicion is we'll see a further acceleration in that regard, you know, particularly as you know, most of these non-core assets end up in private equity hands and they are sitting on unprecedented levels of dry powder.
Any other strategic themes that you're seeing?
Yeah, I'd say beyond the theme of corporate simplification, probably the biggest other trend we've seen is a pickup in the level of all equity transactions, which are really merger transactions. Again, that's no surprise. You know, that is a trend we've seen in prior crises as we come out of them. It's really driven by transactions within sectors where relative valuation is less of an issue because most of these companies will be trading at broadly similar valuations and where there's a sizable pot of synergies that creates a significant amount of value for both sides of the transaction. And I'd say that has been a reasonable pickup in our current pipeline as we look today and we look forward for the rest of the year. It's interesting though, as you start to look at these transactions in a bit more detail, the one thing that may constrain those and may constrain transactions more generally is the chief executives are pretty focused on a sense that we're entering into a period where there will be greater government intervention in transactions, particularly in those which are perceived to be sectors of national importance. You know, none of these will surprise you: healthcare, aerospace and defense to a degree, technology.
And what about ESG? One of the things that we keep hearing is that ESG has really taken a front seat during the pandemic and the economic shutdown. How are you seeing that play out?
The amount of debate we're having with chief executives about corporate responsibility more generally, relative to other themes, is significant. You know, there's no question that they feel a great deal more pressure right now to have a clear purpose and to have a social license to operate. And look, by the way, one of the things we see and we hear is constantly that it is a very complicated time to be a chief executive. I think for many years, business people were capable of sitting out and opting out of having a view on a number of these social and political issues. But it's really very hard to do that right now. And I think leaders in the business world, as with leaders elsewhere, are expected to have a point of view on everything from racial equity to China to boycotting Facebook to ESG.
And what are you seeing specifically in Europe in terms of ESG?
Yeah, look, it's interesting. You know, there was a short period in the immediate teeth of this crisis, you know, in March, April, where ESG didn't feel like it was a primary focus at all of corporates. But that was a very short period. And actually, subsequent to that, if anything, we've seen a real acceleration in Europe as chief executives, you know, focus on ESG components. You know, I'd say in that regard, it's interesting if you look at the statistics, you know, the statistics, at least in the equity markets, tell you that over the last 18 months, we've seen material inflows in the equity markets, well over $125, $130 billion at a time when we've seen, you know, well over twice that in terms of outflows from non-ESG funds. And, you know, in particular in Europe, you know, we've seen ESG assets under management, you know, rise from 2-3%, you know, to closer to 7-8%. So I think those statistics, you know, they obviously tell you how important it is, you know, to investors. you know, and Europe continues, I think, to be, you know, at the cutting edge of this. I would say to you, you know, as we spend time with chief executives on this, they get that it's important. They're very focused on it. They are also very frustrated by the fact that there is no common or unified scorecard by which to judge, you know, who is good and who is bad as it relates to ESG. You know, our suspicion is that that will change. We're working hard to catalyze that change, and that we'll see something more akin to how the rating agencies score credits, you know, in ESG world.
Finally, Anthony, there seems to be a real sense of cautious optimism about Europe right now. Can you explain what's driving that?
Firstly, I'd say, you know, for the first time in a long time, there's a high degree of confidence in, you know, in the politics of Europe. You know, there's a sense that the leaders of the EU and the ECB, you know, have moved with speed, and, you know, the nature of the policy as well as the speed of the decision making has been very impactful relative to prior crises. You know, we all know that, you know, historically Europe has found it very challenging to make quick decisions and to act coherently. But so far during this crisis, they've done exactly that. I'd say the other thing that's really been fascinating as we focus on Europe is the sort of interesting change in the composition of growth in Europe. You know, historically, I'd say Europe has lagged the US suddenly for the last 10 to 20 years in growth. That's really been a function of the fact that the corporate landscape in Europe has been dominated by big oil and gas and by financial institutions. What we've seen in the last 12 to 24 months is, you know, a change in that composition. You know, we've seen the growth in technology here as much as you have in the US. We've also seen a big pickup in healthcare. And the combination of those two trends, you know, have really helped quite a great deal to redress the sort of growth imbalance between the US and Europe. By the way, we touched on ESG earlier. I'd say also, you know, as regards ESG, whether it's renewables, you know, clean energy, green energy, you know, all of those trends have been very active here in Europe. And I think, again, those are driving pretty significant outperformance in, you know, in growth equity relative to the US.
Thanks, Anthony.
Thanks for having me, Liz.